If you've ever rambled alongside a Midlands creek, through a cane patch, or across a marshy bottom, you might have walked by a woodcock and never even knew it. But it's a different story and a sight to see when you go on a woodcock hunt with a well-trained dog.
Easy, Rube.
Easy.
Oh, yeah.
All right, Tony, your bird.
I'm going to try and flush it that way.
Okay.
You could probably come over here if you want to. Pretty point. Let's see if I can make the shot though. That might be the tick.
You don't get to see that often.
No, that's good. Here. See which way. I haven't attempted a shot.
He's facing that way.
Yeah.
Y'all say when.
Well, let me.
Uh-oh.
Get nervous. I was getting nervous. Yeah, that was a good little.
Yep.
I missed.
All right.
I give you a classic woodcock miss.
They know how to do it. I should have had that bird though.
Woodcock are a really interesting bird in terms of their habitat use and in terms of their physical characteristics. They have a really long bill that's adapted to probing for earthworms, which is their primary food source. They have a short, chunky body with more or less rounded wings, which enables them to make short bursts of erratic flight, but they're not really adapted for long, sustained flight. In addition, they're extremely camouflaged. Their primary defense mechanism is to hold tight and let predators pass by them. So as a result, they're very camouflaged. The best way I can describe it is it looks like leaves. A woodcock on the ground, even to a hunter who watches a woodcock land on the ground, a woodcock in its natural environment is nearly indistinguishable. Most of the time, the only thing you can see is the eye of the bird glistening, and the rest of the plumage blends in perfectly with the background. It'd be very easy for a hunter on foot with no dog to simply pass by a bird and never know that it was present, because it would never flush as a result of that. So the dog work, in addition to being a rewarding part of the sport, I think is very critical or key to success in finding woodcock.
This was not a very big one.
I would say either immature or a male.
Yeah.
Hunting woodcock is probably closest to hunting bobwhite quail, the difference being primarily the habitat that you would hunt in. Other than that, there's a lot of similarities. People will either use pointing dogs or flushing dogs. Either one can be very effective, but for many upland bird hunters and woodcock hunters, the dog work is the most important part of the experience.
For me, that's one of the most enjoyable parts of woodcock hunting or quail or grouse hunting is working with the dog. It's that partnership. Some of my earliest memories were actually when I was too young and little to carry a gun. I'd follow up behind and walk behind my dad. And one of the things that was instilled really early on is to always trust your dog.
The training of a pointing dog, and seeing a dog point back and retrieve, those type things are what the experience is about. So a pointing dog probably has a slight advantage.
There it goes.
Got the tree.
Yeah, you got the tree.
I nailed that tree. I figured I better let him know where I was.
If you don't have an honest point from a dog, I let him fly.
See, if that had been my dog, because I used a flushing dog, I got a shot.
Oh, yeah.
Well, here it goes.
From my standpoint, using a flushing dog,
it
adds an extra level of excitement, actually not knowing when the bird's going to flush or exactly where it's located. The flushing dogs can be very effective. It's a matter of reading your dog, because a flushing dog is not going to stop and pause and point like a pointing dog would. But it's a similar experience. It's just a little bit faster pace with a flushing dog as opposed to a pointing dog.
If we say they're getting birdie, then sometimes we can tell that, sometimes we can't. But birdie, Troy.
All right.
Careful, Dixie. There he goes. Did you shoot?
Yeah, did you shoot? There goes another one. He got up.
Did it?
Yeah.
In any type of upland bird hunting or small game hunting as a whole, safety is absolutely paramount. So it's really important to know where your fellow hunters are. In that light, we typically align in a line, you know, line up, you know, three abreast and make sure we know where everybody is. The guy in the middle has got to be very, very cognizant of where the guys on the flanks are. But that's really based on a lot of times on the dog work, keeping the dog in the zone that you want to hunt. It can be done with three hunters and one dog, or three hunters and two, or even three dogs. If you know your fellow hunters, you know their dogs, and the dogs can be controlled. But it's really a safety thing, and it's based on covering more ground, with the theory being that the more ground you cover, the more chance you have to flush the birds that might be present in that habitat.
Good girl. Come here, baby. Come here. Hey. Give me that bird. Leave it. Good girl.
Their short wings lead to that erratic flight pattern. They're not extremely fast flyers, but because they're flying in cover and because they're flying erratically, they probably appear to be a lot faster than they are. So despite the fact that they're not really fast flyers, it's very challenging shooting when you combine their erratic flight with the type of cover that you're hunting them in. So a lot of times you're looking at fleeting glimpses of the bird above cane or privet or one of these other vegetation types that you're typically hunting woodcock in. Woodcock season in the Eastern Management Unit is limited to 30 days consecutive. In South Carolina, we set our season as January 2nd to 31st. That's based on the ending of deer season, as well as some research that was done in South Carolina in the 1980s, which indicates that our peak woodcock, wintering woodcock population in South Carolina typically occurs the second or third week of January based on their migration.